Around the year 1857, a mysterious vagabond was seen traveling around the states of New York and Connecticut. By the time the American Civil War rolled around in 1861, it was noted that he stuck to the same circuit between the Connecticut River and the Hudson River. Due to the hardships of the time, many people had no work, no food, and no roof over their head. Yet despite this, the mysterious man lived on and would soon become a mythical figure who walked through various towns which happened to be on his route. During the 1800s, roaming vagabonds weren't anything unheard of. Locals knew of those who lived near their town, and if they stayed close, their stories would soon become known. Yet this man was different, and much more mysterious than any other vagabond. Whenever anyone tried to get close to him or learn of his story, he became even more distant. It was stated that when locals asked him about his background, he would suddenly end the conversation and leave. He was described as a harmless-looking man with a silent, plodding figure. Yet, due to his very peculiar look, apparently high-strung horses stopped and wouldn't move until he passed. Nothing about this man was known, except that he followed the same long route year after year. The long circuit he followed took him around 34 days. He repeated it over and over, going through the same towns in western Connecticut and eastern New York each year, and he walked a total of 365 miles. Some of the towns he passed through included Brewster, Terryville, Greenwich, Summers, Hamden, and Wilton, among many others. While he followed his route, the mysterious man would always be dressed in leather. His unique leather suit is said to have weighed about 60 pounds. Due to his clothing, which included a hat, scarf, shoes, and other clothes all made from handmade leather, he became known as the Old Leatherman. During the years the Leatherman spent roaming, he lived in caves and rock shelters, spending most of his time in the wild, only stopping at towns for food and supplies every 5 weeks. These Leatherman caves, as they were known, were used to store food and other goods. Following the Leatherman's death, they became points of interest in the area, and to this day they remain so. On the 7th of April of 1870, an article on this mysterious man was published. They called him the Leather-Clad Man, and tried to reveal the little information that was known about him. In the article, they mentioned that he was very tightly lipped. It said that when he did communicate, he only used words with one syllable, as well as grunts and gestures, such as pointing to his mouth, asking for food. His English was noted to be broken, yet rumors claimed that he would occasionally say the odd French phrase. This made many believe this was his native tongue. What he lived off isn't exactly known. It's thought that he had money, which is odd as he refused it from others, but somehow, he managed to purchase basic resources. One shop kept a record of his orders, which included a loaf of bread, a can of sardines, a pound of fancy crackers, a pie, 2 quarts of coffee, and 1 gill of brandy with a beer bottle. As the Leatherman passed through towns, he drew attention to himself. His distinctive appearance and incredible punctuality made people wonder how it was possible, further spiking their interest. His peaceful, harmless nature made many people grow to like him. His punctuality was such that locals noted you could tell the time by his schedule. Apparently, it was considered a great honor for him to stop at your door for food. So in some circumstances, friendly locals made food for him and handed it over at certain times. The Leatherman would always be at your door right on time, then he usually ate the food on the doorstep. Moreover, in certain schools they had a Leatherman Day, The best students would be selected to take supplies to him, as it was seen as a privilege. In 1979, the state of Connecticut passed a tramp law. This gave the police the ability to arrest and imprison hobos. Yet it seemed that this law did not apply to the Leatherman. In actual fact, around Connecticut, 10 towns which were on his route decided to exempt him from the newly implemented state law. As time passed, stories about his life arose. One of these claimed that the old Leatherman had been falsely accused of a crime in some distant land. To avoid imprisonment, he fled to the States, while the woman he loved tried to clear his name. Some theorized that he had a devoted wife who had suddenly passed, which gravely affected his mental balance. Other theories mentioned he was Jules Bellet, and started to call him such. The story tells he was born into a very poor family, but despite this he managed to get a university degree and fell in love with the daughter of the owner of a leather factory called Marguerite Larron. However, he didn't approve of his poor background. Despite this, the factory owner gave Jules a chance, but after a disastrous investment, the young man from Lyon lost all the company's funds and thus the woman who he was madly in love with. After having lost everything, he moved to America to live out his years in despair. From that point on, he roamed in solitude, clothed in the substance of his ruin. This fascinating tale was actually totally false, yet to this day it remains to be told. During the years he wandered, the Leatherman survived freezing temperatures, strong winds, heavy snow, and even the Great Blizzard of 1888. Inside his Leatherman caves, he lit fires to try and keep warm in the winter, but this didn't always work, as his face was frostbitten on many occasions. However, he did keep all his fingers, unlike other vagabonds at the time and area. During the time of the Great Blizzard of 1888, which was one of the most severe recorded blizzards in American history, the Leatherman was arrested, yet it's thought that this happened as the locals were worried about his health. During the blizzard, the old Leatherman was found in one of his caves, nearly frozen to death. Following this, he was treated in a hospital and revived. A diagnosis stated he was sane except for an emotional affliction. As he had money and wished to be freed, he was released and continued to live as he had done for years. The Leatherman was found dead on the 24th of March, 1889, in one of his regular shelters called the Sawmill Woods Cave, near Ossining, New York. The cause of his death was debated. Some accounts mention that it was due to mouth cancer from his extensive tobacco use. Others claim it was from a strange head injury. The Leatherman received a proper burial by locals, fit of his celebrity-like status in the area. He was buried in Sparta Cemetery in Ossining, New York. On his headstone it reads, "Final resting place of Jules Bellet of Lyon, France, the Leatherman, who regularly walked a 365-mile route through Winchester and Connecticut, from the Connecticut River to the Hudson, living in caves, from the years 1858 to 1889. Yet, this wasn't true. Strangely, when his grave was exhumed in 2011, his remains weren't found. There was no trace of his body. Instead, all the workers found were some large coffin nails. Following this, the scraps of his life were gathered and reburied in a more central location in the cemetery, with a headstone that reads, more appropriately, the Leatherman. Very few things were ever confirmed about him, making him a true man of mystery. When his corpse was found, a French prayer book was among his possessions. This, as well as his French-style footwear, and the fact that he declined meat on Fridays, allows us to speculate that he was French Roman Catholic. but apart from that, little else is known. It's likely that we will never truly discover who the mysterious Leatherman was. His unknown life and origins give more creed to his legend in life and after in death. It's because of this that he was so widely known by locals and relevant to this day.
Thank you everyone for watching this video on the old Leatherman. I hope you all enjoyed Mortis Media's narration. I think it's one of the best out there. Anyway, I'll see all of you in the next Forgotten Life. Thanks!